We humans use a lot of different energy sources to power up our small corner of the universe. From fossil fuels and hydropower and wind power and biomass and geothermal and tidal energy, all to the solar and nuclear energy. We have a very versatile sources of energy, but if we think about it just a bit more, we can see something in between the lines here. Let's simplify this list first. Fossil fuels, coal, oil and natural gas are all remnants of the long dead plants and animals, the very same plants and animals who use the power of our sun to grow and to live. So in a sense, these energy sources are just sun power, but in a slightly different form. Hydropower, the basic idea of this energy source is that the water constantly circles around, from the ground to the sky and back down again. And what makes the water circle around? The evaporation cycle that is driven by the power of our sun. Wind power is the same, biomass the same as the fossil fuels. Geothermal? Okay, that's a bit different. When we think about geothermal energy, we are talking about the fact that the interior of the Earth is hot. The deeper we go, the hotter it is. And that's great because we can exploit that form to generate electricity and whatnot. But why is the interior of the Earth still hot? I mean, the Earth formed 4 billion years ago. You would think that after all that time, sitting in the coldness of the space, that it would cool down. And you would be mostly right. Apparently, Earth's crust is a really good insulator, so about 20% of the heat still comes from that period when the Earth was formed. The other 80% comes from the fact that the Earth is filled with radioactive material that decays all the time. For the sake of the argument here, we're gonna ignore these 20% and geothermal energy becomes nuclear energy, but in a slightly different form. So in the end, we mostly have only two basic energy sources, nuclear and solar energy. But if you think about it even for a second, you'll see that they are almost the same, almost being the keyword here. Yes, they are both exploiting the fact that the mass can be directly converted to energy. We've had nuclear reactors since 1950s, but they differ from the sun's nuclear reactor. Here on Earth, we take a really big atom and split it apart, and that process releases a lot of energy. In the center of our sun, something completely opposite happens. The small atoms, mostly hydrogen and helium, are pushed together so hard that they bond to create bigger atoms. So what's the difference? Fission reactors that we have today produce a lot of energy with a very little amount of fuel. To put it in some perspective, 1 kilogram of uranium can technically produce around 3 million times more energy than 1 kilogram of coal. That's how potent the fission is. The fusion, on the other hand, is 3 to 4 times more energetic than that even. That's why fusion is such a big thing, and that's why the sun is so powerful. But here on Earth, 150 million kilometers away from it, it ain't so powerful. Yes, the amount of solar energy reaching the surface of the planet is so vast that in 1 year it is about twice as much as will ever be obtained from all the Earth's non-renewable resources of coal, oil and natural gas combined. And uranium, of course. That's a lot, but we can't cover the entire Earth in solar panels. But there is a better way. Instead of catching bits and pieces of solar radiation that hit the Earth, what if we were to build a sun here on Earth? Imagine that, a small sun in your backyard that would power the entire Earth. Welcome to the fusion power, the type of energy production of the future. Nuclear reactors that we use today are great, but they have a history of being dangerous and they leave behind a lot of radioactive waste that we must put away somehow. The fusion reactors are a bit different. Not only that we could produce a lot more energy, but all of that without radioactive waste, without almost any waste actually, without the chances of the meltdown and other dangerous problems that follow our current reactors. And one more thing, without expensive radioactive fuel. Fusion reactors use deuterium and tritium as a fuel. We produce tritium and we can find deuterium almost anywhere. Up until recently I thought that we didn't have fusion reactors, but I was wrong. The first fusion reactor was built more than 50 years ago. In fact, nowadays you can download the plans from the internet that explain you step by step on how to build one in your garage, right now. But this whole story sounds too good to be true. And in a way it is. The biggest problem we have with fusion today is that it takes more energy to start the whole fusion process than you can get out of it. For example, in 1997, joint European torus produced 16 megawatts of power, but it used 17 megawatts of power to do that. ITER project plans on building a reactor in 2030 that will output 500 megawatts and use only 50 megawatts. that will be our first major shot at this energy source. This is all amazing and mind-blowing, but this is not the point I'm trying to make here. Maybe ITER won't work out as planned. Maybe it will. Maybe we'll have fusion reactors connected to the power grid in less than 3 years. Or maybe not. But someday, possibly within our lifetime, we will accomplish this. We will create an inexhaustible source of energy. The real sun in our backyard. What are your thoughts about this? Leave them down below. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.